I'm opening.
We have an eye, sort of a nostril, two teeth. One of the teeth has a small cavity. Close call, folks, but I think we got here just in time.
Presented by Maria Menounos and Kevin Undergaro. This is Anatomy of a Movie. In-depth discussions and breakdowns of various movie titles. And now that you've seen the movie, let the dissection begin.
Well, hello, movie fans, and welcome to the Popcorn Talk Network's Anatomy of a Movie. Today, we are going to be talking about the quite good sports movie, McFarland, USA. Please allow me to introduce to you a newcomer, Stef Z, first time on Anatomy of a Movie. Be kind, gentle, put your hands together, say hey, Stef Z.
Hey, guys, how you doing? And I even come in spirit, rocking my McFarland sweatshirt.
Sweet. And Stef Z is joining us today because she has some really special insight. She was actually on the red carpet at the premiere.
Yes.
And she went to the McFarland USA press conference. And yes. So she has some really good insight and details. We were talking just before the show. I found it to be very fascinating. You will too. And also handling our ones and twos are the tech aspect of the show. And she will be chiming in is the great Marisa Serafini. Say hello, Marisa.
Hello, everybody. Yes, I did see this film. I thoroughly enjoyed it. And yes, I am running the ones and twos today.
Awesome. Listen, folks. I have to do this shout out before we start talking about McFarland USA. What do we have in the background going on?
Hello? I'm not sure.
All right. Well, before we begin, I just wanted to, I have to do this shout out because it's something that's important, near and dear to my heart. As we all probably have heard already today, the great Leonard Nimoy has passed away. If you watch Anatomy of a Movie, you know that I'm a really huge Star Trek fan and that it has had a major impact on my life. Very sad day and passing of Leonard Nimoy. May he live long and prosper in our hearts and minds. And that's enough about that. We will talk about McFarland USA. So first up, as we talk about this, thoughts on the movie?
I thought it was, overall an amazing movie. I feel like, you know, the basics of this movie, making cross-country exciting and passionate, you know, overall, for a sports movie genre, that's a hard thing to do.
Sure.
And they really executed it. Mm-hmm. I thought it was a heartfelt movie. I thought there was a lot of life lesson in this movie. And, I mean, I walked away being happy. It was quite a long film, too. I believe it was just over 2 hours.
Just a hair over 2 hours.
Yeah, I think 2 hours and 9 minutes or something like that. So to be, you know, in that, like, to be intrigued and to be captivated for that long is something special, and I think they nailed it.
Yeah, I agree, Marisa. What about you? What did you think of McFarland USA?
I like this movie. Being a fellow runner myself, yes, cross country can be one of the most, and I wouldn't say boring, but it's not the most visually, you know, type of sport to watch, because you see at the beginning, you see a bunch of runners run away, and then 15 minutes later, you see everyone come back. So I like how this film, like, really added the excitement to a sport that's like that. And also, this movie had heart and characters and the stories that just go with a small town that might just be easily overpassed and overlooked. But that, like, it has that family sentimental aspect to it, which I think for a Disney film, like, really did a good job doing that.
Yeah, I agree with everything that's been said this far. And, you know, for me going into it, it's tough to do a sports movie, I think, of any kind. When you're talking about cross-country running,
right.
To watch cross-country running could be about as exciting as watching grass grow. So how do you do this? And again, it's not when going into this movie, it's not like I didn't necessarily know where the movie was going to go. It was, how is it going to get there? And I found myself really liking this movie a lot more than I expected. I think because of its heart, because of its cultural diversity, what it showed me something different. It's weird. As I was watching it, I was thinking about that animated feature, Book of Life, which showed me this whole like pastiche and colorful thing of Mexican celebration and thing. And this showed me a culture that I felt was true and that I come to learn actually was a really true depiction of it. And most of all, it had character and heart. And as the director, Niki Caro says, you know, she didn't want to make this a movie about the white man coming, the white man savior. And it's not a movie like that. A sports movie can easily fall into that category, but not here. We have Coach White.
Yes.
This movie is based on a true story of Coach White coming into McFarland, USA. And it's not about him just becoming this coach. It's him becoming, ingratiating himself and putting himself within the community. So he gives, but he also, he learns from his experience in this movie, and he becomes part of this community. And that, to me, is a major focus of this movie, and that which makes it really touching and gives the heart to, you know, a sport that is arduous for the runner and arduous for a spectator if you're just watching. But because it had so much heart, I felt that this movie really succeeds. You know, for a two-hour movie, you're talking.
I agree with you. I also agree. I feel like this movie, there's so many things in what you just said that are so awesome to talk about. I feel like not only did this movie, it touched on culture, it touched on discipline. I mean, even the way that Coach White gets to McFarland, because, you know, he loses his job because throwing a cleat at a locker and it ricochets and hits, you know, the star player in the face. And, you know, there's a lot of things how times have changed with sports and discipline. And sometimes I question what these coaches and what these sports can do for kids, and what kind of red tape we're putting on these things in order to have children be disciplined in sports today.
You know, it's great that you bring that up, because that is that is what kicks off like this. That's the spark that leads them to McFarland. But it's funny because earlier this year we had Whiplash, which is about a coach who is exactly like, he's not just throwing shit at people, he's slapping them and everything. And you're right, like, would that be tolerated? Is that a great method? And, you know, our Coach White in this movie, he understands that he has some demons within him that he has to work out. And I feel that this movie is a resurgence. It's his resurrection. He's coming up from out of the ashes, and he has to, it's also a movie about redemption. Yes. Of oneself. And, you know, when you watch a movie like a Whiplash, and you see that harshness, it's just like, wow, could people really put up with this? And in this one example, Coach Whitey, it's like you said, he didn't even throw it at the kid.
No.
It was just bad luck. It strikes a locker, hits the kid, you know, and then the kid goes crying to his parents. But the kid was a jerk, let's face it.
Such right? a jerk. And I don't see where I come from, being an athlete all my life, I don't disagree with that method
sure.
of discipline, that tough love. And it was funny, in the press conference, Kevin Costner said something to the effect, I don't want to be quoted, that, you know, if that was today, that coach would not be going to McFarland, that coach would be going to court.
Right.
And, you know, and it also, you know, not to get on a tangent about this, but it also makes me think, you know, will great sports movies continue, you know, as we put the, you know, tape on coaches and so, will great sports movies continue to be this great? Because there's always this arc of a lesson.
Sure.
So it's going to be interesting what happens.
Yeah. Like I said at the top, I think sports movies are tough to do.
Yeah.
Because ultimately, they can go one of three ways. It's win, lose, or draw. Okay.
Right.
So, and it's not about the winning. Like some of the best sports movies, it's not necessarily about the winning, but it's about the journey and how they get there, and how either the individual, as in say Rocky, or the team, say as in the Bad News Bears or the Titans. You mentioned Remember the Titans as being one of your favorite movies. You know, it's about how individual and or team gets from point A to B to C. And then it's about the learning the lessons of, you know, it's winning's not the pinnacle. Maybe staying in the ring for 9 rounds or 15 rounds. That's the temerity. That's what you have that's your character. And in this movie, it not only is really about winning, but it's, can you finish the race? And how is it going to be done? Are we going to work together as a team? How do we do this as teamwork? Yeah. And when you get to the end and what the Team McFarland USA accomplishes, it's fantastic, but it's in the way in which they did it. And that to me is what the crux of this story is about. Well, they did it as community.
Yeah, I think you just, again, hit it right, you know, the nail on the head there with the term winning. You know, a lot of people think, you know, me being athlete, winning, I like to win, don't get me wrong. But a lot of people think that winning means more score at the end or the trophy. But to McFarland and to Coach White, the fact that they got this program was a win. The fact that they, you know, figured out how to live, the White family, in this community was a win. The fact that their children adapted to this community and then fit in was a win. You know what I mean? There's so many wins in this that the ultimate win isn't necessarily what you think it's just going to be the result of your sport.
So. Yeah, and sometimes, and to quote Kevin Costner too, sometimes a sports movie really is about, we let people see what's possible, that what can you exceed beyond your own wildest expectations? And again, when you look at some of, like, Remember the Titans, McFarland USA, the original Bad News Bears, Rocky, even Rudy.
Yeah.
You know, when it's all about what you can exceed, your own wildest, you know, that you can do this, no matter if you're short, overweight, too skinny, too maybe too tall. It's all about that drive. And where do you get that inspiration from? You know, we were talking about how coaches can inspire. And again, I'm going to bring up Whiplash again, because that's one way to inspire somebody to play better. Maybe not the best way. Definitely not the best way. Not a maybe. There are so many better ways. And a movie like McFarland USA captures one of the great ways in which to inspire kids that, yes, you can be part of this community, but you can be better than what those other people think about you.
Yes.
Right?
And
you were talking about coaches and how they influenced you in your life.
I do. And I feel like I've actually traveled to some schools as well, and we've polled kids on this, if they listen to their teachers, their parents, or their coaches more. And mostly everyone says coaches. So I do think this is, and I think that that's exactly why, because no matter what sport, and if you look at all of the great sports movies, the lessons are similar. I mean, they're not the same. It's different times. It's different things that they're trying to do. But the basic of that. And I also think that's why sports movies are so great, because you don't have to be an athlete to get it. It's such a, for lack of a better word, an elementary lesson that everyone can take with them.
Right.
So that's, you know.
Yeah, agreed. And to your point too, because sometimes a studio will go out to make a sports movie just to grab the male audience, where I think the best sports movies are the ones that go cross-section. You want men, you want women to get involved in this, because, you know, women play sports, and there's no reason to exclude them from a great emotional experience that a very good sports movie can give. You know, yes, there are some movies like a Major League or so, you know, that's made for comedy, and you hope that it's a good date night movie, but the sometimes what I think is a great misconception is that sports movies are for men only.
Yeah. But even like Major League, if you think about Charlie Sheen and his journey on that movie, there's still that underlying great life lesson being learned.
Sure.
So I think that's, and I do, I believe very passionately that sports does teach you those lessons.
It
teach you how to win, how to lose, how to be a team, how to, you know, what you bring to the table, what other people bring to the table, how to gel together as a unit, but how to hold your own. Like, there's so many things. And again, I think McFarland did a very good job at showing us a lot of these different things.
Absolutely. And Kevin Costner too. I mean, let's face it. This is one of this is Hollywood's go-to guy actor for when it comes to sports movies. He's done like 7 of them. A handful of them will fall in the halls of greatest sports movies ever. You know, I mean, when you look at a movie like Bull Durham, Field of Dreams, those movies are just put in the top lists of great sports movies. And to point, they're not necessarily about the sport. They're about a life. They're about characters. And when Kevin Costner came on board, he's like, well, number one, he's never played a coach. He's never played a coach until McFarland, USA. And he was inspired by, he was in part inspired by the Sports Illustrated article that was written about Jim White. And he was like, wow, this is such an inspiration, you know, and he too had his baseball coach, Jim Barnett, he talks about as his baseball coach.
Yeah, he talked about him at the press conference as well. Yeah.
And, you know, when you have a guy like Costner, who's been around forever, you know, these are the kinds of roles that he really excels at. You know, he can play the everyman very well. He's almost Jimmy Stewart-like, in which he can just go in, he can play this role, and he's not playing the same guy. He's a totally different guy than he was in Field of Dreams, in Bull Durham, in Tin Cup, you know, even For the Love of the Game. He's very sympathetic. And you can tell that his character, that Jim White is playing Jim White, how much he loves and cares for his family. And his goal is to protect his family and to earn for his family. And Costner carries that off, I think, brilliantly.
I think he's brilliant. And, you know, some of the things that he talked about was it's because he's an athlete. He loves sports. And I think when you have that passion, I mean, because come on, Kevin Costner is at a point in his career, he picks and chooses his roles pretty much. You know, I mean, I'm sure that's not, you know, whatever, but he can. And I personally think we should induct him into the Sports Hall of Fame just because he's played it all.
And he has, you know, and again, he's looked upon. He's been in movies that are revered amongst sports enthusiasts, amongst movie fans, movie critics, and just people in general, all over the world. He's done some great things. And so him being involved in McFarland, USA, he definitely is the rock in this movie, in which, you know, he was inspiration for all his cast members. But this is the kind of movie that he excels at, that he's great. He's a very good actor to begin with, but I love seeing him in these kind of roles because he does it so well. It's almost not even like acting for him.
Yeah, it's effortless.
Yeah.
He just shows up and it's who he is.
And it's not that he doesn't do his research.
Yeah,
it's
not that he's lazy, but it just comes natural to him because, like, I would want Kevin Costner as my coach.
Right. Exactly. And I don't even say, oh, Kevin Costner, another sports movie. I say, oh, okay, I'm in. I'm going to, you know, I want to see how this one is. And McFarland USA really struck a chord, you know, and in major part because of him and how he played his character.
Yeah. The thing that, for me, why I don't get, you know, quote unquote, sick of seeing Kevin Costner in these sports movies is because so quickly in these movies, you're not even aware that it's Kevin Costner. You're just looking, like, he's Coach White. He's Jim White. You know
Absolutely.
What I mean? And as such for all the other movies he's done as well. So that's why I think he really, I mean, he could do 12 more sports movies and I'll be there every single one watching.
And it was great, too, that Kevin Costner himself, he grew up in Visalia, not too far away from McFarland. In fact, he's even said that his high school played McFarland High School in baseball and such. So he has for those in Los Angeles and California, he has that local flavor, but he understands the culture from which in this movie he's playing in. And I found it very funny because in one question he was asked, and I found this off of Movie Phone, of all places, but it was hysterical. He was asked, like, wow, it's like he ate a lot of enchiladas.
Yes.
he had to eat a lot of enchiladas. And he's like, oh, my God. He's like, Jesus, enough already, you know, in the dinner scene. But I got to tell you, the dinner scene, I don't know about you, but I wanted an enchilada, like, right off that plate.
I wanted to go.
Right.
So I was like, I want to go.
Scene. That whole scene was a great scene, too, because my favorite part of it is he went to the household to talk to the parents because they had just pulled the Diaz brothers They said, no, they don't have time for this silly running thing. And he went to try to go convince them of that. And they invite him in for dinner. And he has this amazing dinner. He feels like they instantly make him part of the family. And when all is said and done, there's that awkward moment outside where he's trying to get the Diaz son to interpret. And then when you find out that the father speaks English, right? Yeah. Okay, so that's a funny moment. But the poignant moment is the fact that he doesn't even. He's like, you know what? I get it. He's like, I can't even. I'm not even going to ask you right now. I have to think of another way to convince you that your sons are doing good. And to, after what you've shown me, he walks off without even attempting to try to convince the family.
Because I really think for me, it was a great, great scene, and he understood it.
Yeah.
And we see that he wasn't going to make it happen in a quote-unquote traditional way of convincing them that this was good for their sons.
Right.
He needed to get more into their world to convince, to see and so that they would understand that they need to go pick in the morning because that's how they support their family. Mm-hmm. So he took it to almost the other angle completely and was like, okay, I'm going to have to go pick.
Yeah, and I think, too, that this is a, you know, a major strength of the screenplay and Niki Caro's direction. Under another studio, or if this movie were made somewhere else, you know, it would have been very easy. It could easily fall back on stereotype.
Yes.
To make a kid look cuter or not, you know, or whatever. And this movie does not fall on stereotype. In fact, I have it on great authority because my girlfriend Brenda is who works at Pantaleon, so it's a Latin American studio. And when she saw this movie, we saw this movie, walked away saying, God, that was such a positive, true depiction. Like, and they just released their movie Spare Parts, which again was a sports movie of sorts as well, similar to McFarland USA. But she had said that it's very refreshing to come out of a movie and not seeing the Latin American culture being stereotyped. And because there are the poor, and this is what they have to do for their families. And it did it in such a positive way that even the people who appeared to be the gang-related people, you know, come off as, no, listen, I was part of that life, but not anymore, and we protected your daughter.
But
there was very, you know, and there was, you did get a sense of family and community. And then once you're a part of it, you're brought in. And we know that if we take care of you, you're going to take care of our kids too. And once they figure out that Coach White's best interest at heart is the kids, then they're going to support him in any which way they can, and they all come together. And I did find that it was great to see, because I felt that it was real.
I felt that it was real as well, and I do give Niki a lot of credit for that. It was real in the sense where you had to show what was really happening there, but it wasn't shown in a way that they need help or there was no woe's me. You know what I mean? Like, there wasn't that we're trying to draw you in to feel bad for a situation. It was more like we're painting the picture so you can understand what happens in this community and how this community comes together as one and does something and includes people in it. Right. And I think that was the big difference. A lot of time when you're shown stuff like this that you might not be, you know, the culture that you were brought up in, you're shown it in a way where it wants you to feel something rather than, I feel like they were just showing it to let you understand what was happening.
Right.
I feel like there's a slight difference.
This is the way that it is. This is how we live. We live off the land. And you're right. There was never a woe is me kind of factor. And I think, again, from the strength of Niki's direction and from the screenplay, we are looking at this from the eyes of Coach White. Whether or not, I've never been a coach, but looking at him, it's almost, you can equate it in a sense as to a fish out of water story.
Right.
But in this one, again, it doesn't, there were no comedic hijinks don't ensue. Like, we're talking about a character who comes in, and even his, say, prejudice or his initial thoughts are one of fear. And what are we doing here? to once he gets ingratiated, once he puts himself in the situation, like going to the fields and waking up in the morning. That's a great scene.
Such a great scene. I think his initial feelings are fear and what are we doing here? But I feel like his initial feelings as well is disappointment. Like he messed up and that's why his family is here.
Right.
So not only, and we see how he doesn't disconnect from his family, but we see how he forgets important things with his family because he's so tunnel vision on making this situation better for his family because not only, you know, like you said, the fear, but I feel like he's disappointed in himself or, you know, and again, he's willing to do anything for his family, mm-hmm. which really at the end of the day is the moral of the story of the community in McFarland that family comes first. Right. So it kind of plays in very nicely.
Yeah, absolutely. And again, when you have a person, an actor like Kevin Costner playing it, it makes it so much more believable that, you know, because he doesn't play, there is a sense of guilt. And there's the sense of responsibility. My family's here because I fucked up.
Yeah.
And he basically, I've got to make right. He goes, you know, his end goal was to get out of McFarland at the beginning.
Right.
But again, I think because of character growth, we know how it ends. And he turns down his offer to Stanford, I believe it was.
Palo Alto.
Yeah. And he turns down this offer to stay and keep his family rooted in McFarland. And that's very special part of this movie.
Yeah, the other thing for me that stood out very much about Coach White is the fact that, yes, he was in a guilt place. Yes, maybe he was out of desperation, but still in that, he was confident enough to think, I'm going to create something here at this school that doesn't exist because it makes sense.
Right.
So to me, that's such a strong character in a sense that he didn't coach cross country before this. He didn't know anything about it. He just knew that he saw a solution to a problem.
Yep.
And that problem solving team, figuring stuff out, putting yourself first because he needed to figure it out for his family, but putting maybe what he wanted to coach second, knowing this was win, showed huge character for me for Coach White.
Yeah, absolutely. Plus it's in filmmaking, in film writing too, that sets up another conflict to overcome. You know, never having coached a cross country, running team, noticing the talent that you could noticing the potential. And then, it's a great scene when he's talking with the principal and the principal's like, you ever coach your cross country team? He's like, nope. He goes, why am I not? So he goes, well, of course you'd be great at it, And so he just sets up these goals for himself as well that he has to overcome. How am I going to do this? What am I going to do? He learns lessons along the way, as do the students. Learn their life lessons as well. And when you do it as one, then it becomes, look, would I have been any less happier, like walking out of this movie, had the team not won, but just knowing that they put in their effort and they worked as a team? Yeah, I would have been like, all right, they came in second. That's an amazing goal and how they did it. Yes, they come in number one, so that helps. They have to go by what really happened. So, you're glad that you don't fudge with that. But it's how they did it, and it's how they got there. The kids were amazing, right? Yeah. The kids were great, and I think it's a great story, and you have some really cool stuff to insight to impart, but three of the kids are actually from McFarland, USA, which is sort of kind of cool.
And I would have not have known that just watching it. I feel like the acting was superb for these kids.
Sure.
I feel like, when it comes to these kids and this team, the way that the team was created, there was such a comic relief to this film as well.
Right.
Like, you're going to detention. Okay, I'm just going to go talk to the principal and get you on my team. You know what I mean? Like when I believe it was Victor that was resisting being on the team. There was these things that, Thomas was resisting as well.
Sure.
Like there was these, not only in overcoming that you're a coach at a new school where you don't want to be because you feel guilt and you don't know anything about cross country. Now you got to find kids that are good and they don't want to run because they just don't care at the beginning. So that whole internal battle as well was interesting. And yes, so Sergio Avalar, I could be saying his name wrong, but he plays Victor in the film. Apparently he was telling a fascinating story how he went to a casting call. A bunch of his friends had told him, oh, you should just go try out for this casting thing, you know, whatever. And he went and he was like, okay, like, I think I did really good. And apparently he heard nothing because the time from when they thought about this movie to made it, there was a lot of time lapse. So it was a year and a half later that he got a call from Niki Caro to be in this film. And he was just like amazed.
Right.
And it was kind of awesome that these kids, and again, I give that credit to Niki, which again falls back into that story of having the confidence and the balls, so to speak, to be like, I'm going to take these kids. Like, I want to live, sleep, breathe McFarland. I want this to be genuine. Right. That's a big word that comes to mind for me for this movie. It was genuine.
Yeah. And the fact too that it wasn't like they needed just one or two.
Right.
They needed a team. They needed seven. And Niki Caro goes on about really getting kids from the area was more out of necessity than by design. He goes, but it worked out so well. He's like, who'd have thought that we went through this very dramatic and emotional rehearsal, and these three kids have, in a sense, lived the story of McFarland, not the cross country, but the living there, the living conditions, what they had to go through. So for Niki Caro and the crew, it became an inspiration as well. And finding these other actors, whether they came from Texas, New Mexico, putting everybody together, I think, again, it's what this movie represents. It is about working together, pulling together, and showing a very positive view of the Latin American experience, especially here in some parts of California.
Yeah, so, which I think is, that in itself, the culture of this movie and seeing things, you know, the quinceañera party and how they didn't know and how inviting this culture is for me. It was very, it wasn't like, what are you doing? How come you're not doing this? It's like, oh my God, you don't know?
Yeah.
We're going to show you. And I feel like that's something that's such a huge thing in life. We tend to see different and it ignites fear rather than being curious. And I feel like that's a huge thing that this movie actually, you know, hints upon as well. It's like, wait, you guys are different, but why and how? And it's kind of cool, so I want to do it too.
Yeah.
Rather than, I don't, you know, and there is a fear in the beginning, but we see that flip very quickly.
Absolutely.
And I really liked that. Something else that I learned when I was at the press conference was that Niki Caro bought a lowrider car. Kevin Costner told us this story just to really, really be in, you know, living the culture. And the scene when they're on top of the car, that's actually her lowrider car.
Nice.
So I really give it up to Niki. She's, you know, a female director, a strong woman. She made this story happen. And there could have been so many things in this movie that kind of went a little bit at askew.
Sure.
That could have threw it off.
Absolutely.
And I feel like they kind of dotted every I and crossed every T. At least to us. I'm sure in the background, a lot of stuff happened like always, but they presented it in a way that it was awesome.
Yeah, no, I loved her direction of this movie for the simple fact that it was efficient. today, we've talked about it on Anatomy of a Movie, of filming movies. You know, many a director and editor relies on fast cuts and doing this and doing a montage and, you know, and especially in sports movies. Yeah. Not here. Not here. This movie did not use film technique to manipulate an emotion. It did not use score. It didn't overscore its scenes to manipulate feeling and thought and heart. Niki Caro as a director really earned it, and it had a 2-hour pace. So this movie almost, in a sense, when you parallel it to cross country running, you know, it's not necessarily about how you start, although in a movie starting is very important, but it's how you pace along and how you come to the finish line and how you end. And this movie was paced as such where it really built up. And by the time we got to the very end of this movie, it was very hard not to clap. I mean, I saw this movie in a small theater. It was a 4 o'clock show, so it was crowded, but not overly crowded. And I swear, if it wasn't thunderous applause from everybody when we see the true students, when we see the real students, when we see how many they won and how it led up to that, it's like finishing a cross-country race, and everybody was applauding.
Oh, I was like, waterworks. I'm that girl. I'm going to let you know. I weep at sports movies. I love them so much. They're so touching to me and inspirational that it definitely triggers emotion. I was literally like weeping. Like I got laughed at that I was weeping. I was just like, it's so great.
Marisa, how about you? Like,
I admit, I watched this and I got very emotional and I got worked up. I was like, that is so sweet. I think the particular moment that really got me was when Danny, like when he saw that his teammate was falling behind and he picked up the slack. I was like, yes, go run, finish that, you know, cross the finish line. And like that just showed so much heart and sentimentality in this movie that because knowing that this was a true story, it just added so much to like people's personality. And like this is a sports movie because you're rooting for everyone,
right?
And it really hit home.
Yeah, the scene that you're talking about too is so great because, like, you know, Kevin Costner, Coach White is like, is that Danny Diaz? Is that Danny Diaz? That's Danny Diaz. And like, you just like going, that is Danny Diaz.
I'm like getting worked up again.
It was great. It's a great scene. And you know, come to think of it, I was thinking, all right, so it's a movie about running, right? And Niki Caro even says, you know, well, of course you have to think about Chariots of Fire.
Yeah.
You know, I got to throw in meatballs because I do. I have to throw in meatballs. You know, it just doesn't matter because... You know, that's what Bill Murray's coaching cross-country running. But yes, the Chariots of Fire is the running movie that you would go to. And this is a movie, too, that we rely on a lot of slow motion in Chariots of Fire. It's a great film.
Yeah, great song.
But Niki decides not to go with little to no slow motion at all. Especially during the running. And I think again, great choices. This movie wasn't overcut. This movie let scenes play out. And the cinematography on this movie with either, you know, the runners with the sun setting and dust coming off of their shoes as they're running, that to me is what was inspirational. That it was the way this film looked. It looked real.
It looked real, and I feel like that's also, it goes back to, it kept the integrity of the film. Mm-hmm. Like, it wasn't forced. I feel like slow motion sometimes, it's like, ooh, if we use slow motion, we're going to force the audience to feel something, or they're trying too hard to have them feel something. And again, like this, like the culture, like everything in this movie, they trusted the film and the story enough that they didn't have to force anything.
Right.
And they were just, that made it that much better for me.
Yeah, and the movie inspired apparently Niki Caro, who wasn't a runner before, but she was so into the weeds, let's say, with this movie that she started to run, and apparently she still runs today.
So, I don't get it, man. I don't understand the runner's high. And I think it comes from me, from being an athlete all my life. Whenever you got in trouble, that was kind of when it was like, Z, take a lap. Like, yeah. I would have to run around the field, so I'm like, I don't want to run.
Yeah, I'll run. I might run for a bus or a train. That's about it with me.
Okay, or if someone's behind me with a knife.
Yeah, or zombies. But in any case, yeah. So,
to add to that,
because you are a runner, aren't you, Marisa?
Yes, I run, and there is a certain characteristic. Not for all runners, but one particular scene is when the teacher comes in and she reiterates the essay that one of the runners talks about, and one of the lines is like, we're free. And I feel that was a moment where, like, that's where the passion of running came in. Not just because they're good at it, is because that is something to look forward to that they had every single day. Other than working in the fields, going to school, it is something that it is on their own time, something they had passion for.
Right.
And it was something that brought them together in that community, and it brought the community together too. And it really formed their brotherhood and their you know, companionship between each other. So I think they adding that story to it really just added the fact that their love and passion for running.
Right.
Right.
No, I agree with you. And again, because it becomes so much more, other than running, there is a passion, but there's also there is the community. There's a sense of team.
Yeah.
And that's important to this film.
I think, too, Marisa, what you touched on, the freedom, I mean, that's so present in this film. I mean, you take the scene of when Kevin Costner takes him to the beach.
Oh,
I mean,
yeah.
That's a freedom that they've never seen the beach. I take that for granted. I grew up on Long Island. Like, the beach was right there. You know what I mean? So many people. But running, like, for me, and I feel like symbolically, there's... the beach is up there with one of the most freest places. You think of all these like resorts or these vacations and you always see like the palm trees in the ocean, you know? Right. So to take them there after they, you know, finally have the uniforms, they're finally, now they're free. You know, that was such a good buildup. And it was just a great scene when, you know, Coach White pulls up and they're like, you know, $8 or whatever they said. He's like, I got $4 and a bus full of kids that have never seen the ocean. And they let him in. That was just...
It was a great
scene. That's when the tears started for me. I was like, oh.
And I know, Marisa, that was one of your favorite scenes as well.
Yes. I particularly in this scene, I love the music that was underneath everything because just the juxtaposition of them finally being able to go to state and then going to the ocean, something, two things that they've never done before, and adding just the music and how beautifully it was shot. It was so simplistic, but yet so emotionally heart-tugging and heartwarming that you're like, all you could do is feel for these guys. And you're like, yes, I'm rooting for them. They deserve it after being hard workers and great runners. Like, this is something, give them this moment of happiness.
Yeah, I agree. And just going, touching back on the music again, I just felt, sometimes in a movie, you know, I'm going to take some of the later Rocky movies, like some of those in the middle, the music is more manipulative. It's to get you pumped up. And for a good sports movie, you know, you shouldn't, for any actually movie, you know, music should be there as a bed to maybe help move that story along and get you, but it shouldn't be the sole purpose as to why you're jazzed up. I mean, when you look at the original Bad News Bears, they relied on classical music. It was like a fantasia of a baseball movie. And that movie and the music, you know, paired up with the action taking place on screen, it just lent to the scene. And whether it was a comedic scene or whether there was, you know, some intensity going on. And in this movie, I felt that the music was just perfect. It didn't overshadow what was taking place. I had a great story to keep me going. And music paired up with scenes that kept me going, but it never came to that bombastic crescendo to tell me that, yay, this is wonderful, you're supposed to feel great. And again, I think it's another piece of sports movie magic that Niki Caro chose to how to make this film that really works. It's sort of kind of like a breath of fresh air. Yeah. Even though we've seen this movie done a bazillion times right? We've seen this movie done, but she did it. She approached it from a different angle. I felt like I felt like I walked out feeling like I learned a little bit. I had a little bit of culture in me outside of the yogurt that I had just eaten. And I felt like I learned something and I came out and I felt good about myself. I felt good about McFarland USA and everybody involved with the movie. They have something to be proud about.
Yeah.
Fantastic.
They do, for sure. One of the other things that stood out for me that I don't hear talked about a lot, so I want to hear what you guys think about this, was Thomas's role before the last race that they show.
Right.
He clearly knows that Coach White has gone to look at a job opportunity in Palo Alto, which would be, you know, quote unquote, better for his family. He'd make more money. They live in a nicer town or whatever they, you know, picture that it painted for Thomas. And he sees Coach White show up and he had a choice there.
Right.
He had a choice whether to tell his teammates like, hey guys, yeah, we're doing all this, but Coach doesn't really care. Like, he's just doing this for him. He's going to get out. Or to take the quote-unquote higher road and not tell that, to keep his team together so that they could accomplish something in order to do it.
Right.
And now Thomas resisting wanted to join the team at all in the beginning. Right. This to me showed, like, that was one of the biggest lessons that I saw and that I fell in love with, that story.
Sure.
Because I thought that was a very it was like the movie was in Thomas's hands.
Right.
You know, and I really love that that character had that story in particular.
Yeah, and it really solidified that Thomas became the quote-unquote captain of this team. He was the leader of the team. And it, you know, and it was a position that, well, A, like you said, he didn't want to be in it. And I think, again, when you're talking about a good story arc, you know, what's best for the team? We came here, you know, he had his words with Coach White, like, what are you doing here? You don't care. And he's like, look, let's just finish this up strong. We'll deal with this after. The choice not to tell the team, you know, during these finals. You know, yes, it's a great character arc, and that the mere fact that that character stuck with it. He was going to lead. They were going to get through this, you know, and then let the cards fall where they may after the race. But, you know, we're here for a reason, and so isn't my community. Right. And what the hell? We can't. We worked hard for this as well. And yeah, you're right. It's a very good character arc and epiphany that he has. And he becomes, in a sense, he's stepping along. You know, it's the it's a rite of passage.
Yes,
for him.
And for me, it was awesome because it was almost. I mean, hero. I think is too strong of a word, but it became the hero role that he chose for the team. And then, right. Like, very soon after that, Danny being like the hero at the end and picking up. It was just very quick how it changed, and it gave, you know, all of the kids a part to play, a significant part. Yeah,
that's what's important too. They played a significant part. It's in a sense. I always go back to the Bad News Bears, but you know, the Bad News Bears wasn't just Kelly Leak. It was about Timmy Lupus showing up, Tanner Boyle. It was about teamwork and what you can accomplish, and especially when it comes from somewhere that you don't expect it. So, you know, is that Danny Diaz that I see? Because they knew they had to make up this time because that one kid, he wasn't thinking. He's out of gas.
Yeah.
And it's like, what are we going to do? And when you see this kid train chugging along, it was a great, oh my God, it's such a good scene. And again, it makes it... it makes going to this movie, you feel good.
Yeah.
You really do.
You feel energized when you leave.
And the kids were great. And even, as you said, the actor Carlos Pratt, I believe is that actor's name. And basically, he was working on the bridge. And he got the call to play this David Diaz, and he really liked the script and
Carlos
story.
Carlos Pratt was actually Thomas.
Thomas, that's who I'm talking about. Yeah, and you know, then the casting director thought that he'd be, well, he actually was going in. Yeah, he said he auditioned to play David Diaz. I love the script. I really enjoyed it. But then the casting director thought he'd be a better Thomas.
That's amazing.
So there's a physicality of the role. You have to be able to run like a runner. And he had that physique. And he wasn't even like a really big runner. He goes, we probably ran two races in the time that it took us to film one. So, I appreciate that. And plus two, how many times is a last minute casting decision made that, you know, and then that person will end up being that iconic person,
right?
Because they were meant to play somebody else. And then it's like, you know what? Why don't you try this out? And for him, it worked out great. And he was the oldest person on set of the kids. So in a sense, they did look up to him as leadership.
And not only that, he was one of the only actors.
Right.
So, and they talked about how they trained for this movie and running. And I believe it was only like a month or two that they trained. But you know, in doing that, and that also brings, when you have people train together and go through the highs and lows of training, that, you know, makes team right away, because no one's ready to do all this running.
Yeah,
you know. And I that was something else too, the training part of this, that I also, with Coach White, how when they trained on the hills, because they didn't have any, he was just so out of the box thinker.
Yeah.
And that really excited me. It was like, oh, we don't have any hills. A lot of people would stop at that and be like, all right, well, we'll just run twice as much. He's like, no, we're going to find this.
Sure.
And then again, in the training, there's the comedic relief of, you know, Kevin Costner showing up, Coach White, on his daughter's bicycle so that he can ride along because he can't keep up running, you know? Right. And he tries at first to run and fails. And he's like, okay, you got to figure something else out. He's just such a solution-oriented coach. And that's kind of what a coach has to be.
And let's face it, too, the running on, and like the hills were shelled almonds. They were like they were the discarded shells from almonds. But it really led to cinematography. Wise, you know, great looking scenery,
yeah,
and shots of them going up and down. Yeah, it was a very well done, very well done, and at the same time, it became sort of like inspiring as well. And just the way that those scenes played out, you know, use your environment, and you know, it's the way you set up a camera, it's the way you let things play out, the way you let a scene play out. How many cuts are we gonna have? But no, or Niki Caro, she used her environment to great success. In this
she
movie.
Did. She was like, dealt, she just, what she, the card she had to play, she played perfectly.
Yeah, and I want to give a shout out too, because I think it's important that Adam Arxbaugh, Terry Stacey, director of photography is on the, director of, or the cinematography on this movie, they were fantastic. We talked about film editing by David Coulson. You know, the editing of this movie, like I said, it just wasn't overcut. And working with the director and trying to, you know, you could easily overcut a running scene, you know, from the feet to this, to sweat, to whatever. But no, they let scenes play out. And I actually got a grand sense as to who was what and where. Which is great in these kind of movies. You know, we talked about the music by Antonio Pinto, which was done very well. You know, even source music played into the flavor of this movie, which was great.
Yeah.
Great. It only added.
And adding to the music, I loved it during like the whole quinceañera scene where they're actually playing music from their heritage and, you know, the Latino culture into it. And I really, that added to the genuine of everything of this movie.
Yeah, I agree. And, you know, when you talk about too, all right, so this movie was distributed by Disney. And, you know, Disney is a company today, you know, they've grown to be, you know, a tentpole, family-oriented type of a company. You know, we've got the Marvel universe, we've got the Pixar universe, we've got the Star Wars, Lucasfilms universe to play in. And the mere fact, for me anyways, that they're still making movies that are non-franchisable, and that they put time and effort. I mean, I love that. I love that from a person who loves movies and who has worked in distribution and on the exhibition side of things, the mere fact that they can make a movie to be released in like a February, you know, which isn't a big movie. This movie all in was around $50 million to make. I read that the production budget was somewhere around $17 to $20 million, let's say give and take, that's estimated. So they threw in about 30 or so million in prints and advertising, or hard drives and advertising. So they stood behind this movie. And, you know, the movie thus far, it opened up to 11 million. It opened up number four in the box office. And currently we're looking at a gross all in right now as of today, about 14 or so million dollars. You know, and they'll do well on Blu-ray and DVD. And they have a 78% on Rotten Tomatoes. That's like certified fresh.
Yeah.
For this movie, the audiences, according to CinemaScore, gave it an A. So it definitely is a crowd pleaser. You know, we all like the movie, right? So, you know, I love the fact, and I hope they continue, because last year they did Million Dollar Arm, which is a movie too that has a lot of heart to it. Did you see Million Dollar Arm?
I did, yeah. Great.
I really, you know, a movie that, again, shows that working together and this kind of teamwork, that we can do this. And again, you know, a good sports movie should have a lot of good heart to it. But they also did that Alexander and the Very Bad Horrible Day, which is a small, it's not a sports movie, but it's a small movie that was a throwback to their like live action movies of the 70s with Steve Carell. And, you know, you can make these small movies, studio folk. Yes, you're going to focus on your franchises I get it. But I'm glad that Disney at least offers us something else other than a superhero movie.
I can't agree with you more, because I feel like it almost restores my faith in movie making. You know, I feel like, and that might sound a little dramatic, but I feel like there are a lot of movies out there that exactly that. They know that they're just going to be the blockbuster at the box office. And I feel like the fact that Disney gets behind films like this, where you're not going to see the return right away in the first weekend, but there's a genuineness to this film, and there's a lesson to learn, and it's for the good of it. And they know, like you said, there's not going to be a McFarland USA 2, right. But it there doesn't need to be. There's a story that needs to be out there.
Yeah.
And I think that the more and more they continue to do these films, the actual return in the opening weekend at the box office will get bigger and bigger, because a lot of people don't, like, they hear McFarland USA and they don't really know what to expect. They don't see all the, like, there's marketing for this, yes, but it's, I feel like it's still in a different caliber of, you know, marketing for the Avengers or something like that.
Yeah,
because there is legs to the Avengers, which is great. I'm not upset about the Avengers, but you know what I mean?
Like, oh, no, this, I know exactly what you're saying.
Yeah, and I do feel that the more that they do this, it's a very good formula that they have for these movies, and it's a formula that no matter how much people might say or disagree with it or not care that much about it, it's proven over and over to work.
Absolutely.
And not only just to work in a sense, but to work in your heart. And I know that sounds so cheesy, but for me, that's important, you know?
Yeah.
So it's very, you know, I really like it. And I like Disney that they do this and keep the movies like this in their wheelhouse.
Yeah, and you know, the best thing about it all is that it offers audiences variety. And it gives exhibitors, those are our theater chains throughout the country, it gives them a movie to put in and to fill up some screens on what is otherwise a slow period until we start working our way up into the summer months and so on and so forth. And again, I'm not going to take away from the tentpoles. James Gunn earlier this week said it best when he was criticizing things that were said at the Indy Spirit Awards about superhero movies and such. And he was going on saying, you know, I'm no less passionate about filmmaking than an independent producer and or director. And I agree with him 100%. I know that he's passionate. And I know that people like Joss Whedon are passionate about their things. And I know even people like Robert Downey Jr. are passionate about film and passionate about doing these things. I'm just glad that we are in a time where Hollywood is starting to take a hit for following franchise tentpole only, where, you know, there are other periods throughout a year that you can't always be doing a franchise. And when you put in a smaller film like a McFarland USA, which is quality filmmaking, very good storytelling, it gets audiences excited and inspired. Like, what's wrong with that?
Well,
and you do it at a lesser budget.
Yeah, well, I don't think there's anything wrong with that. And to add to your point, I feel like the passion of all these filmmakers making a film is probably very similar, but there's more access to the passionate filmmakers that their films equal dollar signs.
Mm-hmm.
And that, I mean, and that's just the way it is.
Right.
So we don't get as many of these, you know, as we do the blockbusters, the superheroes or stuff. I'm a huge superhero fan.
No, I'm a huge superhero fan too, but, you know, I would never negate the passion of Ed Wood, but he didn't make good movies. He made movies that I would laugh at. Somebody like a Joss Whedon, a J.J. Abrams, like, these are the Spielbergs to me of today. Like, you know, Spielberg had a passion to make movies, as did Francis Ford Coppola, Martin Scorsese. Like, all of these people had a passion to make film, to make movies, and to make great stories. Regardless of whether they're big and or small stories, you know, there is a passion there. And Niki Caro had a passion in this movie. And I think it showed on screen how much she had a love for the subject matter that she was that she was filming about.
Which I think is very important because, you know, we touched on this a little bit earlier. But, you know, when we see culture and things that we don't know, a lot of people go to the fear and the I don't understand, rather than going to the curiosity that, oh, maybe they're doing something that's super fun that I should be a part of. Yeah. And in this movie, we see that happen. And that's such a beautiful thing, because we all come from different places. We all have different experiences in life. And to be able to share those with one another rather than think differently of one another is kind of, I don't know, to me what it's all about. So this movie really touched on everything.
Yeah, absolutely. And as I said earlier too, it didn't fall into stereotype. Nope. Just think about how easy, and again, I'm going to try to choose my words carefully because I do not want to offend anybody, but this movie could have easily, under somebody else's hands, this movie could have fallen on stereotype. The accent could have been completely overblown. Like a Boston accent can be overblown, and like it could have been done to caricature and not character. And once that happens, and then you set up, then you get sort of kind of like a Mighty Ducks 2. Like
right.
where oh, isn't he cute because of his accent and people are having a hard time understanding him, other than putting this white family into a situation and, okay, they may have a hard time understanding, but they don't make fun of it. They take the time to learn, and they take the time to learn the culture. And this isn't an overblown accent. They're not riding low riders, and they're not shooting people and doing all, you know, they're not playing to certain stereotypes. And that to me is such the strong part of this movie, where I literally felt it was one of the reasons why you're inspired. You come away, I felt like I learned something.
Yeah. And I think, again, that goes back to the woes. Like, we sometimes in movies show these situations and we feel like we're expected to make people feel bad if something is different.
Right.
And that wasn't. This was just a legit showing and building a scene so that we could all be in it with the film,
right,
knowing what's going on.
Sure. And again, Jim White's character, he could have been called, like, Chris Smith, and he comes from another school and he's going to be the savior of this school sports because he's going to bring with him the experience and he's going to make the football team number one and he's going to teach these Latin American kids the true meaning of football. And that's not what this movie is about.
Exactly.
And that's what makes this movie, I think, special. Part of the things.
The other thing too that I don't believe we touched on real quick is I feel like Coach White and Coach White's family was, you know, I feel like how, Cheryl White's character kept, you know, she trusted him. You know, and I felt like that was very important for the family to adjust. So that was, you know, again, in bringing this culture together, because if he would have had one more problem at home, like him and his wife weren't getting along or she was combative or not trusting him, I feel like that would have, again, made it not as authentic.
Yeah.
And as not fun to watch is maybe not the right way to say it, but it was fun to see that he had that support even when he was almost losing hope, and then how that turns around and the family actually doesn't even want to leave McFarland, even though he gets this job offer at Palo Alto.
And so it would have been so much better for them, a better standard that we think.
For them was being home, and McFarland was home, which we see, because a lot of these characters, the real runners, who I got to talk to some of them at the red carpet, which was so awesome, but they're all back in McFarland.
Right.
Because that's their home. And for me, that's so awesome.
And how amazing was it? And Marisa, chime in too. How amazing was it that when, like, these runners, they went off to their lives, and they not only did they come back to McFarland, but they were giving back to the community. They were teaching, they were coaching, they were doing this, and they were inspired by this one man who they inspired to be a better man. I mean, that's the part that is great. They came back home, and they wanted to coach and teach the kids and be better, and they're all landowners, and that's a great part of this movie.
It was great. And I actually, on the red carpet, got to ask one of the Diaz brothers about that. That's the assistant coach now. I don't believe he was in the movie. He was the third brother. Apparently, there was three brothers in real life, but they only had two for the movie or something. And I asked him wanting to get the answer that he gave me. And I was like, you know, what does it feel like? What's that responsibility to try and fill Coach White's shoes? Mm-hmm. And he was just like, you can't, so we don't try. Right. And to me, that was so amazing. Yeah. That moment, just like they got it. Like these kids got to be a part of, you know, history almost. Yep. I know that sounds super bold, but it really is.
Well, it's part of McFarland's history for sure.
And so, also a history of, you know, having films like this and learning about this culture. And, mm-hmm. you know, people should know things like where this came from and why. And
I think that this is a great film. Well, everybody should try to go see this. But yes. I also think that it's a great, I think it's one of those great films that can be shown in schools.
Yes.
You know, and there's so many things that conversation-wise for students could be brought up and talked about. Maybe it'll inspire students who otherwise may not have any interest in sports to at least try out for soccer, or maybe go running, or try out for the track team. I don't know. Well, why don't we start to wrap things up? We'll go in final thoughts. Marisa, I'm going to throw it out to you first for final thoughts in the movie and anything else you want to interject.
No, I think you guys covered everything. I really, really enjoyed this movie. For a sports film, I don't think we see enough of them. I mean, because we only get maybe one, two good sports films every year, and you know, Kevin Costner, you can't go wrong. He was just, his character, I mean, you know, Coach White, I thought he brought a lot to, you know, just the story that needs to be brought to the forefront, and especially for a sport such as cross country. I can't think of any other movies that touches upon this particular sport.
Chariots of Fire.
Chariots of Fire.
You know, other than Chariots,
but like most recently, I mean, you see a lot of football, baseball, and you know, that's great, but to bring such an overlooked sport and adding heart to it, I think Disney did a great job bringing that, and also the sense of culture for the Latino culture, and you know, that heart and sentimentality and family, and you know, really bringing people together and bringing a small community together to root for each other and breaking that stereotype.
Absolutely.
I think for Disney films, very solid.
Sure.
Yeah, I just feel like, you know, again, I go back to Niki Caro, and maybe it's because I got to talk to her and she told me she was going to give me a ride in her lowrider, so I'm super excited. But I, which I'm totally coming after you for that ride, Niki. But I just feel like there was so much opportunity to make a poor choice.
Sure.
And they chose right.
Mm-hmm.
They just chose right, which made a great film. I was pleasantly surprised. Not that I didn't think this was going to be a good film, because, you know, as a sports fan and a fan of sports movies, they tend to be good. But I didn't think I was going to be this affected. I didn't think that I was going to love it so much, and that it was going to cross over into so many different aspects of life.
Mm-hmm.
Rather, you know, so I was very pleased with that. And again, a 2-hour, 9-minute movie that just went by so quick, and I cried. Like, it was a fulfilling experience for me. Thank you.
It is a fulfilling experience. And this movie, like I said, I was pleasantly surprised. I did not expect to like the movie, or to like this movie as much as I did. It plays out very well. The movie has a bunch of heart. And, you know, you can't go wrong. And it's done in a very organic way. The movie, to me, again, seen this kind of movie done a bazillion times before. I think it's hard in this day and age to make a good sports movie, because I've been brought up on some of the best that there've ever been, and it's hard to make a good sports movie and to get people to go. I think McFarland USA of this year, in most recent times, I think it's a very good sports movie that's not necessarily about sports, but it is in a sense about the human condition, and that's what really makes this movie work for me. So hopefully you've enjoyed our breakdown of McFarland. Please contact us. Let us know what you think. Let us know what you think of our breakdown of McFarland. Maybe you saw something that we didn't touch upon that we should have. I know I will occasionally check on the comments, and I'll write you back if you're not too mean. So, please subscribe. We are the Popcorn Talk Network. This is Anatomy of a Movie. You can find the Popcorn Talk Network on YouTube. Subscribe to us. It is a network made, invented, created for you, the movie fan. Consider this your ESPN, folks. We're 24/7. We have so many great shows about movies, and we'll break it down for you 24/7. We're here. You can always come on to Anatomy of a Movie. Please voice your opinion. Let us know what you think of the movies, and because we will always let you know what we're thinking. Marisa, where can people find you outside of the booth?
People can find me on Twitter at SerafiniTV.
And Stef Z, welcome again. Fantastic job. So happy you can join us. You offered some amazing insight. Where can people find you?
Thank you. You guys can find me on Instagram and Twitter at IAMSTEFZ. And yes, let me know. I would love to talk more. I'll respond to all you guys. Just tweet me.
And if, for those who are looking to find me, I can be found in the Popcorn Talk Network, Anatomy of a Movie. I do have Twitter. It is at DMovies1701. That's at DMovies1701. Please continue to watch, continue to comment. We love movies. We know that you do. Thanks for watching, movie fans. We'll catch up with you next time. We've got a ton of movies to talk about in the near future. So keep clicking in. Thank you very much. Bye.
Bye-bye.
And this has been Anatomy of a Movie.